It is great to be here today to be able to talk to you or to give you today's message, but also talk a little bit about camp. See, we just got back yesterday. We had an amazing work day. We got the camp, getting the camp ready, and we're excited. We're ready for another exciting season to come. See, this year, just like every other year, we're going to impact lives for eternity. Now, a lot of you remember Ralph Condon. He was a longtime member here, one of my trustees and a dean of mine. The first time he visited the camp, he said, looking out, he said, "This is the place where kids find God." And I can tell you, your church camp is a place where kids find God. And even more, go in a deeper relationship with him. I hope you guys don't mind me sitting down. I did a number on my foot on Friday, so bear with me, please. People, when your children come to camp with an open heart, God is not just going to fill up their heart with his presence, but he is going to overflow their hearts with his presence, and that's exciting. This year, our theme is change the world. So your child is going to be challenged in very practical ways with Christ's teaching how they can change the world. And I think that's important, and I hope you think that's important as well. So please send your kids to camp. And I'm really excited to bring the message today. You're starting your transformation. And I get to talk a little bit about your spiritual transformation today. And the key verse that you guys are going to be looking at for the next few weeks is Romans 12:2, that says, "Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind." Now, maybe some of you can relate on this. Do you have someone in your life that just drives you a little crazy? All right? Maybe it's a brother or sister. Maybe, I heard, husband. All right, wife. All right. A few years back, I had a coworker that just pushed my buttons. You ever had a coworker do that? All right. And one particular day, we had to have one of those tough conversations sometimes you have to do as a boss, you know, and he just, his head was so thick. Oh, I'm getting frustrated just thinking about it again, right? All right, and I kept thinking about it, and what happened to the rest of my day? I let myself get moody, right? Got myself grouchy, and next thing you know, I realized that nobody wanted to be around me. Why? Because I let myself get upset, and because of that, my actions were negative, and people no longer wanted to be around me, right? What happens is what we think about is how we feel, and how we feel is how we act. Does that make sense? So if we really want to have transformation, we can't start with our actions. I can't just tell you guys, go out, do this. First, what we need to do is change our thoughts. So we need to start challenging ourselves and thinking different ways and in different subjects and starting to think at them differently in order that we can be changed. That's the key to transformation, is focusing on what are we thinking about. I mean, that's what Paul is talking about in Romans 12:2 when he says, and that's what we're going to be looking at for you for the next several weeks. You guys are going to be looking at that. You're going to be looking at different parts of your lives and how you can change them. You will be challenged to ask yourself, how can I change the way I think about these different things so that I will feel differently? And now that I feel differently, I will want to act differently, and I will want to respond to people differently. And that's called transformation. Transformation comes when we go from emptiness to fullness. When we allow God to help us become the people he wants us to be. And to do that, we need, you know, and that's how we're going to do when we look at our spiritual health. See, the closer we get to God, the more our life is going to transform. That makes sense to everybody, right? The closer we are, the easier we can be transformed, and the easier our life will be. Now, I'm not saying that life is going to be easy. I'm saying it's going to be easier. There's still going to be rough times. You're still going to have hard times. But when you're close to God and being transformed, He's going to help you with the heavy lifting. He's going to do all of the heavy lifting, and He is going to help you be changed. Knowing that makes all of the difference, doesn't it? In Isaiah 53, it says, "We are all like sheep. We have gone astray. Each of us have turned to our own way." Right? So in other words, we want to be close to the shepherd, but we are dumb animals. Right? And we get distracted, and we think we can do it better, and we cause all kinds of problems in our life. We know that the closer we are to God, the safer we will be. But we tend to wander off. So how do we stay close? How do we do that? Especially if maybe some of you here have felt like you have fallen away a little bit, and you're struggling a little bit, how do you get back? How do you strengthen the relationship or to start a relationship with God? And Jesus told a story to help us do that, and it's the story of the prodigal son, okay? And a lot of people, if you've been going to church for any amount of time, you've heard a sermon on this. But bear with me, we're going to pull out some really great principles out of it, so don't tune out just because you've heard a sermon like about Luke 15 before. Stay tuned. We're going to really get some great stuff out of this on how we can transform our life spiritually. So let's look at Luke 15. We're going to start in verse 11. Jesus told this story. A man that had two sons. The younger son told his father, "Give me my share of your estate now instead of waiting until you die." That's nice. His father divided up his wealth between his sons. A few days later, he packed up all of his belongings, and he left to live in a distant land. All right, so what it's saying here is he is getting as far away from his father as possible. There, he squandered his gift that had been given him by wasting his life, money, on wild and parties and reckless living. About that time, all of his money ran out. A severe famine hit the land, and he began to starve because he was left with nothing. All right, so we see him now that he had everything, now he has nothing. He's getting hungry. The only job he could find was feeding swine on the farm. He became so desperate and hungry, even the pig slop that he was feeding the swine looked good to him. But no one would give him anything for his hunger. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "This is crazy. My father's home, even the lowest paid workers eat well, and I am far away dying of hunger. I'm going to return to the home of my father and humbly say, 'Father, I have sinned against both God and you, and I am not worthy to be part of this family or to be called your son, but please just let me be one of your servants.'" That works for you. All right, so I know I can't be a family member anymore. Just make me a servant. With this attitude, he headed back to his father, but while his son was still a long distance away, the father saw him coming. Filled with joy and compassion, he ran out to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said, all right, so the son started his prepared speech, "Father, I have sinned against you, I've sinned both God and you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." And then you see here, the father just interrupts him. But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring me the finest robe in our house and put it on him. Get my signet ring and put it on his fingers and put shoes on his feet. Roast the calf we have been fattening. We are going to celebrate with a feast of eating and drinking. For the child of mine who was distant and dead, but now he is back and alive. He was lost, but now he's found. Let's party." See, that's incredible. See, we tend to wander away from the Creator. We tend to wander away from our God. And it doesn't matter how far away we are, He still loves us. He said, he was very self-centered in the beginning of the story, wasn't he? "Give me, give me, give me, and I want it now." And then he wasted his money, he wasted his time, he wasted his energy, and he hit rock bottom. He became homeless, he had nothing to eat, and he had a horrible job. I kind of picture when Jesus was telling this story to the original group that heard it, that those Jews just shook their head in disgust when he said a Jew child was feeding pigs. I mean, that was the worst. No good Jew would ever do such a horrible thing. That's not kosher. You're not supposed to be anywhere near pigs. I mean, this kid was rock bottom before he came to his senses. He said, "What in the world am I doing? I know I don't deserve my father's love. I know I wasted what he gave me. I know I don't deserve it. But maybe he will hire me as a servant." This story, we can get four things or four pathways to help us for spiritual transformation. And the first one is to get fed up with my life. When you get fed up, you'll get fired up, right? When you say, if you right now are thinking, "I'm fine where I'm at, Rex," well then, and I'm sure the ministers here don't like me saying this, but you might as well not even come for the rest of the time. Because if you're already saying you got it all figured out, you're not going to be transformed, okay? We all say, you know what? We've all screwed up, and we really need to be able to get that and embrace God and really figure out where we've fallen. We need to get fed up, and then transformation can start. So that is the first step, is getting fed up with the way that we are living. In Jeremiah 29:13, it says, God says this, he says, "You'll find me when you're serious about finding me and you want me more than anything else." God is going to reveal himself to the person that wants him more than anything else. God is not going to reveal himself to somebody that treats God as a hobby. Does that make sense? We cannot treat God as a hobby. And then we have to do the second thing. The second thing is we need to own up to our sin. The world doesn't like this part, right? Own up to our sin. We need to say, you know what? We've sinned, just like this young man did. He said, "I have sinned against God, and I have sinned against my Father." And nothing is going to happen until we can come to that stage where we say we have sinned and we have hurt God and we have hurt fill in the blank. And that is stage two. We need to get fed up and then we need to own up. Isaiah 59:2 says, "Your sin has separated you from God and has hidden his face from you." Okay, so your sin is what separates you from God. God isn't walking away from you. You are walking away from God because you have put something in your life that only God should be at. All right? So you have taken something and you have made it into an idol and you have put it in a spot that should only be for God. And I'm sure you've heard this before. An idol can really be anything, can't it? It can be the car that you drive. It can be your job. It can be the way you look. It can be your money. It can be your success. It can even be the game of golf, right? Anything you put in the spot that only God should be, that is sin. Because of that sin, you are separated from him. And you need to say, "God, I don't want that in my life. These things are bad, and I need to get them, they're bad in themselves, but where I've put them is bad. And I need you to help me. I need you to help me." See, only we can blame ourselves for where we are at with God. I could sit there and I could tell you guys, it was that employee's fault of why I was in a bad mood and I lost my joy, right? But whose fault really is it? It was mine, right? We can't blame anybody else for our spiritual condition. The closer you are to God, the closer you will understand him. But what is God's response when we own up? Well, I can tell you, he does not rub your nose in it, does he? Let's look at a prayer that King David said after he committed adultery, all right? And then he had Uriah killed, you know, Bathsheba's husband to cover it all up. You guys know that story, but this is in Psalms 51. It says this: "Be merciful to me, O God, because of your constant love. Because of your great mercy, wiped away my sins, washed all of my evil, and made me clean. I recognize my faults." That's important. "I recognize my faults, and I am conscious that I have sinned against you." He recognized his faults. He owned up. And God's response to this was this: "No matter how deep the stain of your sin, I can remove it. I can make you clean as freshly fallen snow." That is a beautiful passage. That's kind of the OxyClean verse of the Bible, right? Once we need to look at ourselves, we need to have a spiritual checkup to make sure we are in the right path for true transformation. Many of you guys know, 6 years ago, my wife gave me a kidney. And because of that kidney transplant, I have to get a lot of checkups. All right? They want to make sure it's working. I have to give blood once a month to get checked up. Why? Because they want to know as soon as possible if that kidney is not working right or if something's not right with me, so we can fix my wife's kidney. All right? Now, you say, why do you call it your wife's kidney? It may be in my body, but it is still my wife's. It is still Amy's, and she wants me to take care of it, right? And so she makes sure I take care of it, all right? When we let sin to go unchecked, we damage that gifted kidney that was given to us. And we need to keep it in check, and we need to check ourselves and make sure that we are doing what God wants us to do. The Bible says, test yourself to make sure you're solid in the faith. Don't drift along taking everything for granted. Give yourself regular checkups. If you fail the test, do something about it. It's a kind of a neat little message paraphrase, right? Do something about it. We need to examine ourselves many times in our lives. Soon we'll be taking the Lord's Supper, communion. What are we supposed to do every time we do that? 1 Corinthians 11 says, a man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread and drinks of the cup. We need to examine ourselves. And then we can move on to the third step, and that's offer up ourselves. Giving up all of us, giving it up totally, becoming a servant. You notice in verse 12, he said, give me, give me, give me, give me my share. You know, I kind of wish you were dead kind of thing. And then in verse 19, he says what? Well, he returns and says, make me a servant. See, that's a real change in attitude. And when you have that change, transformation can happen. But I need to tell you, it's not going to happen overnight. All right? This is something that's going to take our entire life. It's never instant. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says this. It says, we reflect on the Lord's grace and are being transformed, which meaning continue process, into his likeness with an ever-increasing glory which comes from the Lord. God wants you to be transformed. He wants you to change like a caterpillar to a butterfly. It's a long process and it's not easy, but the end result is what? Stunning, right? And it's so much better in the long run. And we should want to be that, because that's what God wants us to be. We first need to get fed up, and then we need to own up, and then we need to offer ourselves up. Romans 12, 1, offer yourself as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. No transformation happens until you offer yourself up, until you give yourself over completely to God, to the Father. And what does the Father do? Verse 20, it says, he was filled with love and compassion. He ran out to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him and said, I've got you. Once you start heading back, he is going to meet you more than halfway. And he's going to run out to meet you, and he's going to throw his arms around you, and he's going to say, I know you screwed up, but I love you. God doesn't hold grudges from all the dumb stuff we did. God has a better plan for us than we can even imagine. I said that I actually broke my foot on Friday. And I'm going to tell you guys how so I don't have to say it 300 times today. Over by the dorms, there's this big box that goes about 7 feet into the ground, maybe eight, and there's some release valves. And I was turning the water on to the camp this week, and one of the valves was leaking a little bit, and it flooded the box, and I had to turn the water off and get the water down, and I was going to jump and see how bad this valve was broken. So it was one of those things. I had my son with me, and I said, Will, give me a minute. I'm going to turn the water on. We're going to check this out, and we're going to go home for a nap. He's two. All right? Leave the car running. Pull right up to the hole. Leave the car running. Open the door. Go over to the manhole. See where it's leaking. Go to climb down. And the 2x5s that were built into the box to be the ladder, as soon as this body hit those rungs, guess what happened? One fell off. It completely broke off. Then the weight of this frame hit the third ring, and that one fell right off. All right, so I fell straight down trying to catch myself the whole way. Pop. Literally, pop. I heard something. Crack, snap, pop. All right. Go to call my wife, and guess what? Phone's in the van. All right. So I had to look at my 2-year-old son and say, all right, daddy's okay, but he needs you to go get the phone. Call my wife, and she's like, I am going to kill you. I didn't tell her how much pain I was in. She's like, how are you going to keep him from not running off? I know, honey, just get here. So she gets here, she gets a ladder to me, she gets out. All right, everything's fine. I get x-ray. It's the bone that's not weight-bearing. It's not the worst break in the world, but it's painful, right? But the one thing that happened while we were waiting for Amy is Will kept bringing me sticks. And he was handing them down, and he says, don't worry, Daddy, I got you. I will save your life. Okay? Now, in that 2-year-old mind, he could take a little bitty stick and pull all of this back up through the wall. Up to the hole. All right? A 2-year-old can't do that, but you know what? As soon as when we're stuck in that hole that we've put ourselves in, as soon as we look up and we say to our Father, help me, he's got the means and the power to pull us out, doesn't he? And that's what we have in our Lord. That is the kind of transformation we can have. And because of that, we automatically do the fourth thing, and that is lift up my praise. Lift up my praise. We can say, thank you, God, for your grace. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your goodness. What did the Father in our story tell us? He celebrated, right? He said, let's have a party. The son that was dead is now alive. Psalm 64 says this, sing to God, sing praises to his name, lift up a song to him, sing to the name of the Lord. We automatically will want to worship him when we're focused on him and we see him pulling us out of that hole. And we're not condemned, but he celebrates us getting out of that hole. Remember a little bit ago, we talked about kind of doing a checkup before we take communion. We need to remember that communion is an act of worship, isn't it? In 1 Corinthians 11:23, it says, on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and he spoke a prayer of thanksgiving. He broke the bread and said, this is my body which was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. He wanted us never to forget about his love. Communion is a time to remember to say thank you for him. It's not a time where he is condemning those sins. He is celebrating that you are holding on to him to be a better person. It's a time to say thank him for his grace, his mercy, and all that he's done for us. Do we want to be transformed? And I think all of us say, yes, We want to be better than what we are right now. And that can happen when we focus on changing our thoughts and embracing Him. Camp this summer, your child will be also encouraged to be transformed. And that's why it's so important I say, please send your kids to camp so that they can be transformed just like we're trying to be transformed. And the camp can help that happen. So let's go ahead and pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you and praise you for who you are, Lord. I thank you for your loving kindness. I thank you for these steps that we can apply to our lives so that we can change the way we think about you and the way we think about things so that we can change our mood, so we can change our actions, so we can be transformed by your love and your grace, Lord. Help us to always remember and help us always to focus on the ways in which you have blessed us so that we can keep this positive attitude that you want us to do to impact this world for eternity, Lord. We thank you and we love you so much, Lord. Just help the people right now. There's so many people here, some who have been walking with you for years, but they need to take that next step, Lord. Help them take that next step. There are people here today that feel like they are a mile away, miles away from you, Lord. Help them to see so that they can come back to you. Lord, help us to be the servant leaders you want us to be, Lord. Help us to remember to give you the praise so that we can continue to improve, so that we can change this world, Lord, so that we can be transformed. We thank you and we love you in your precious name. Amen.